Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another new edition of Africa Today, where we get you the latest news taking place on the African scene. And our main topic today will be the Africa Arab Economic Forum, but we'll start with this report. The United States proposed that South Sudan's rebel leader Riek Machar, its army chief and its information minister face UN sanctions for fueling violence in the war-torn country. More details in the following report.
United States circulated to the 15-member United Nations Security Council to impose an arms embargo on South Sudan and further targeted sanctions amid warnings by a senior UN official of possible genocide. Political rivalry between South Sudan's President Salva Kiir and ethnic Dinka and his former deputy Riek Machar, anywhere, led to civil war in 2013 that has often followed ethnic lines. The pair signed a shaky peace deal last year, but fighting has continued and Machar fled the country in July. Adama Ding, UN Special Advisor on the Prevention of Genocide, last week visited South Sudan, which gained independence from Sudan in 2011. Samantha Power, U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, told the Council that Ding's warnings should serve as a wake-up call. None of us can say we didn't see it coming. The United Nations Security Council has long threatened to impose an armed embargo on South Sudan, but veto powers Russia and China are skeptical whether such a move would make a difference, as the country is already awash with weapons. China also voiced its opposition to embargoes. The Security Council set up a targeted sanctions regime in March 2015 and has blacklisted six generals, three from each side of the conflict, but subjecting them to an assessed freeze and travel ban.
Welcome back. More than a dozen people in Sierra Leone were infected with Ebola but showed no symptoms, suggesting that the massive and deadly West Africa epidemic was larger than previously thought. Details follow.
Ebola but showed no symptoms, suggesting that the massive and deadly West Africa epidemic was larger than previously thought. The findings by a team of scientists at Stanford University offer new evidence to support previous theories that the hemorrhagic fever Ebola may not always cause severe illness, including bleeding, vomiting, diarrhea, and fever. Some 28,000 people were infected with Ebola in the outbreak, which began in late 2013 and continued through last year, killing more than 11,000 people, mainly in Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia. Ebola, like most other viruses, can infect people but show few symptoms. Stanford researcher Jenny Richmond, who specializes in infectious disease and anthropology, said, Ebola is spread through close contact with bodily fluids of an infected person, including blood, vomit, and diarrhea. Since many patients become violently ill, family members and medical professionals who care for them face a high risk of infection. Researchers recruited 187 men, women, and children from Sudoku, a rural village of about 900 people in Sierra Leone, from the study. Participants had likely been exposed to Ebola through a family member or by using a public toilet shared by a person who had the disease.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, and we're glad to be joined today by Mr. Mohammed Abdel Ghaffar, President of the African Economic Council. Good afternoon, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon to you.
And, sir, of course, today we'll be discussing the Arab-African Economic Summit. How do you see the significance of the summit? What are the main topics on the agenda of the summit? Of course, terrorism, fighting terrorism in African countries and Arab countries, and, of course, cooperation between Arab and African countries on the economic level will be topping the agenda. But what other topics will be on the agenda of the summit?
This is the fourth summit between the Arab world and the African countries in the African continent, and it comes after the third summit, which brought a lot of goals for the cooperation between the two bulk of countries. You know, the Arab countries is like one-fifth of the African continent. We have 11 Arabian countries out of 54 countries in the whole continent. They are aiming to boost the cooperation, especially in fighting the terrorism. A lot of automations have been done to face this threat, trying to destabilize the growth and the economical development in the African countries, and also would like to change the concepts and the peaceful life used to be in the between the African people. The second aim, they also promote the trading automation between the African countries and the Arab world. Mm-hmm. The North African countries, it is more developed than the sub-Saharan countries. So they have a lot of industries they can export, and they also can transfer the technology for the African countries to get added value of the natural resources they have in the sub-Saharan countries. All of this like building a strong relationship should be discussed. They put decay plan for the cooperation to create a new economical bulk in the South area. It also strengthens the South-to-South cooperation, mm-hmm. and it is one of the most important aims the underdeveloping countries used to working on during the 60s and the late 50s.
Mm-hmm. Right. A declaration is also expected to be issued by the Arab African Summit. Would you please tell us more about this declaration and its significance in coordination on the political level between Arab and African countries?
Of course, they put an ambitious plan to develop both the Arab countries and African countries. And it called the 2063. It is like a 30 years plan, mm-hmm. for working hard on the cooperation in the two important bulk. You know, the Arab countries, they have they are rich of the income of fuel and energy interests, and the African countries, they are rich of the natural resources and the human power, mm-hmm. fertilized lands, moderate climate, which encouraging investment and even other industries like hoteling, tourism. All of these industries is very promising in the African countries. Mm-hmm. They also even work together on the cultural scale,
right.
to put a common concept between the Arab world and the African countries to change, mm-hmm. some of the heritage or negative heritage being left from the colonialism era.
Mm-hmm. Right. The summit will discuss also a project on expressing solidarity with the Palestinian cause. How do you see the significance of this issue, and how do you think it will be tackled during the summit?
The African countries played a significant role on in the Arab Zionism struggle, mm-hmm. and we used to go to voting in the United Nations We guarantee 53 countries voting to us, plus the 14 Arab countries, plus the non-allied countries. So we used to have like two-thirds of the vote quorum in the United Nations. So the African countries used to support and used to adopt the Palestinian fair course.
Mm-hmm.
And they also recognized the new state country for Palestine.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the African countries at the time being, they have embassy for Palestinian state.
Mm-hmm. Right. The summit also is expected to discuss the role of transportation, which is very important in promoting Africa-Arab trade and investment.
Exactly.
How can this be strengthened to further promote trade between Arab and African countries?
It is a very ambitious plan to have like a corridor, like this corridor joining the north to the south, which been developed by President Sisi to establish Alex Cape Town Road or Alex Cape Town Corridor.
Right.
There are also other corridors to join the west, the western coast of the African continent to the eastern coast, also to open new corridors for the landlocked countries like Congo, DRC, or Ethiopia, Uganda. A lot, one third of the African continent, they are landlocked countries. So there are like a big map for establishing roads, airports, even rehabilitating the seaports already there in the African coast, that to join the trading between the north to the south and from the east to the west, and it's going to even to achieve a lot of progressive on the economical state for the African countries.
Mm-hmm. Right. Such gatherings are very important, of course, and crucial to developing cooperation between African countries and Arab countries. How can such gatherings be further utilized in order to boost cooperation?
Actually, such gathering it gave a very good opportunities for the leaders of the Arab world countries and the African countries to start discussing the plans, discussing the opportunities of investments, how to give more attention for the Arab investment. We saw what have been done in the three main economical communities like COMESA, EAC, and SADC in the south.
Mm-hmm.
And also we have some Arab treaties. It's also for the free zone area treaties like Marrakesh Treaty, Agadir Treaty, all of this giving advantages for boosting the trading between the Arab world and the African countries.
Mm-hmm.
Also, other like financial organization like Islamic Bank trying to fund a lot of projects, especially in the infrastructure, to establish new roads and also establish industrial project in the African continent to put some processing or treatment for the natural resources, not to sell them as a raw material, but to sell them as a finished product or even semi-finished product. And such project we need for the more advanced country, especially in on the industrial sector, like the North African countries, the Arab countries in the north. They have more accumulation of experience and more advanced in the industry. Mm-hmm. Such industries really going to help the African countries to get real use and tangible benefits of their resources they used to export it as raw materials.
Mm-hmm. And what are the expected recommendations of the summit?
I think there are going to be more treaties about removing the trading obstacles to reduce the customs between the African countries and the Arab countries. Also, there are going to be treaties for exporting the energy and for, you know, the energy in the African countries, especially fuel, it is very expensive there. Mm-hmm. Like any liquid kind of fuel, it costs like $1.6, right, which causing like reducing the advancement, and it is a big challenge for the industry there. Mm-hmm. And it is a big benefit for the Arab countries to think about the African market as encouraging market to export their products, especially fuel products or oil products, to the African countries. And they started that before, and nowadays they are focusing on the African market to export and to promote their production to export to the African countries.
Mm-hmm. Right. In your opinion, what are the most important steps to be taken to boost cooperation between Egypt and African countries on the economic level?
Like put a lot of fund for the development projects in the African countries. Mm-hmm. We have the African fund. It can offer some fund for the development project. Especially one of the very important sectors for the African countries, the education sector. Mm-hmm. They also trying to gather the efforts, like the facilities have been offered by TIC, and also through the Arab African Culture Institute to promote the education level on the African mm-hmm. countries. Other sectors to offer training and give more skills, more practical skills for the young men, for the African youth to become trained power or trained human power. They also cooperating on the agriculture scale mm-hmm. to reclaim or to cultivate their needs from foodstuff in the fertilized African countries, mm-hmm. which very fertilized, and they have enough water for the agriculture production. Also, the climate is different from the Gulf countries, which give more facilities to get different groups.
Mm-hmm. And in your opinion, what are the major challenges that Egypt should start facing to boost its cooperation and investment with Arab African countries?
One of the most challenging we are facing for long time since the 60s, it is the awareness of the ordinary people about the African continent and how far the cooperation on the governmental level going to. The governmental treaties spread a lot of tense between to encourage the cooperation between the Egyptian producers and the African market, but not all of the producers and even not all of businessmen mm-hmm. they know about this tents and these opportunities they have there. Even some of these treaties, they gave a guarantee for their production and for their export to the African countries to cover the LEC. This is one of the benefits which give a great advantage for the exporter, for the businessman to focus on the African market. Mm-hmm. We would like also to put in the back mind of the government or some of the governmental agencies here that when they offer enhance for the exporter to export some of the fruits and vegetables, for instance, that enhance not supposed to be to any countries. Mm-hmm. We would like to encourage the Egyptian producers to get that advantages they have in the African countries, so we can direct such subsidiary mm-hmm. for the exporter to the African countries.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, the African countries are full of natural resources that are not yet utilized. What's hindering the utilization of these natural resources so far?
Actually, the African continent used to be suffering of the colonialism for a long time, and one of the main concepts they got from the colonialism, they don't have to promote for their production. Mm-hmm. They have to keep it there until some of the buyers come and give you some money to take it.
They don't care about promoting and marketing.
Mm-hmm. They also don't work hard to transfer it from raw material to finished product. Mm-hmm. Standardization. They have to do some study to give clear specs about these natural resources. They don't have such standards to mm-hmm. promote for their product. Mm-hmm. They have to show all.
They need more research, maybe to find out
even,
the locations.
Even
and
the modern tools of researching, they don't have it there.
They don't have.
Yeah.
Right. Mr. Mohammed Abdel Ghaffar, President of the African Economic Council, many thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, with this we wrap up this edition of Africa Today. Many thanks for watching and stay tuned for more coming up here on Nile TV International.